Okay, welcome everybody. Good morning. And welcome to another Course CE class. Really glad to bring you some REPC test questions today. And I know, like, who would want to sign up to take a class which is a test, okay? But the good thing about this one is we're only going to post your results on social media. So it's not, you know, I'm kidding. We're not going to post any results, okay? Like we just said, this is for fun. So REPC test for fun. Who would have thought? Kevin Cameron says, crazy people think marathons are fun. So maybe we're all a little crazy, or at least Mark and I are crazy, because we really thought this would be a fun time. So maybe we should expand our horizons, Mark.
Perhaps.
A little.
All right. Well, welcome everybody. Okay. So here's the deal. If you need CE, go ahead and put that in the chat and we'll get that roster going. We do have 100 limit today. So we're well over 100. So if you came in a little late, I'm going to have to see what I can do. Either beg the division for a variance or we're just going to have a nice class. If there's any of you on the class today that don't need the hour, would you let me know in the chat so you can kind of give up your spot? That would be great if you don't need the other hour, okay? Remember, you only need 18 hours. We all know that that's not enough to be a professional, but you only need 18 for your renewal. Today, REPC. We're going to talk about REPC questions. We've got 25 REPC questions. We're going to ask them. We'll put them up on the screen. You can write down your answer, and then we'll give you the answer after we give you a second to contemplate it, okay? I think I'd have for materials, I'd have the REPC handy if you can, and so we can reference that. Big picture, guys, you've heard me say this, I think a million times in my career. I really think there's two really important factors to what we do as professionals. The marketing side of real estate is paramount. Nobody would argue that. It's huge. It's what we do. It's what we're hired to do. But the technical side, which is our forms, the legalities, the process of the transaction, really complicated. It's getting more complex all the time, especially in our new market conditions. It's very challenging. So big picture here is to become a professional at the highest level and study and be better, more proficient at these our contracts. And today we'll focus on the REPC. Look, the value proposition for real estate agents has been around for decades. You know, what are we worth, the commissions in which we charge? It is my passionate belief that if we will turn up the volume on understanding the technical side and be better surgeons at what we do, then we will be obviously communicating and showing our value, and we benefit, the public benefits, and we're justified in the rates and fees that we charge. If we do not ramp up our understanding of the technical side of the business, I think we're in for a lot of scrutiny. And so I would beg and plead with you to get on board that these things can be fun. There's a lot of things in my life in the past I didn't really like so much, but I love today. Yes, running is one of them, Mark. I do like to run. I didn't used to. I kind of like going to church now, you know, but as a teenager, that wasn't very fun. And don't get me started on what I thought about the piano. Growing up, you know, but I enjoy the piano today too. So look, you can love things, you can find a space for that and love things that maybe you don't currently have a passion on. Okay, are you guys ready? You ready for our first? So we've got a warm up. We've got six questions that are just warm ups. Okay, so here we go. Joe, go ahead and start off with question number one. Go ahead and write down your answers, guys. And I'd love to see you show me your answer. I think later on in the chat, I'll have you just chat with me and see who can get some of these things right without sharing the answer publicly. Here's the question. If the buyer's earnest money deposit is to be held at a title company, what must be done? Go ahead and write that answer down. That's question number one. These are warm-ups. These are, frankly, kind of the easy ones, okay? I'll give you about 5 seconds to contemplate that one. Okay, either know it or you don't, right? What must be done if we're going to deposit earnest money at a title company?
You should commit suicide.
Okay. All right, from our comedy corner, Kevin Cameron, who's brought the humor this morning. All right, let's answer this one. So, Mark, you want to take the answer?
Sure. There is an addendum for deposit of earnest money with a title company that would need to be filled out. And kind of the primary purpose for that addendum is oftentimes, regardless of what the parties have agreed to in the REPC, the title company has its own requirements. And oftentimes that requirement for the release of earnest money will be signatures from both buyer and seller. So it's important to execute that addendum and have your buyers and sellers aware of that potential additional requirement that may be at odds with the REPC.
Yes, and it can be at odds because of the language that says without further written authorization. So look, we're not going to dive in really deep to all of those, but yep, that's the answer. Nice job. Let's go on to number two.
But what he didn't say was you can just write an addendum that says to be deposited in a title company. You cannot do that. We see too much of that.
Yeah, true, Kev. Thanks. Yeah, we want to stay away from writing language ever on an addendum that we already have a UAR or approved form for. Very good. Okay, question number two. Joe, go ahead and pull up number two. Okay, so this one we're going to call a four-point test. This was a little more challenging. So this has to do with section 1.1. So without looking, so let's see how well you do on this. What's the four-point test for an included item? Meaning there are four things that must be affirmative for an item to be included. See if you can get all four. And if you do get all four, maybe give me a thumbs up here and let's see how you did. Okay. And yeah, if you want to chat with me, that would be great too. So what are the four things that are required for an item to be included? It's an interesting way to look at it. You know, it's like we've got to get different perspectives. Okay. All right. Anybody got all four? All four, anybody? No, I see some head nods the other way. not this way. Nobody wants me to unmute them. Is that the thing? Uh-oh, they're on to me. I guess I should study the REPC. All right, well, let's look at it. You know, this one, I think we could probably, Mark, when you answer it, I'll have the REPC pulled up, okay?
Sure.
So let's share screen. Okay, here's page one of the REPC. Here we are, section one. Okay, Mark, what's the answer?
Section 1.1. The first item would be it has to not be excluded. You'll notice the language says unless excluded, the following items are included. So it has to not be an excluded item. It can be one of the items listed there in the laundry list you'll see in section 1.1. That's the second point. And it has to be owned by the seller, and it has to be in place on the property. So the operative words are not excluded, item listed, owned by the seller, and in place on the property. It's right there in the first, three of the four are right there in the first opening clause of that section 1.1, and the fourth being the list.
Nice. Okay, we're not going to spin it. We got 25 of these guys. We can't go deep dive into all of these. But I hope that helps you when you're thinking about what's included. There are a couple of exceptions to this. So consider fixtures and attachments that are not listed are usually considered real property. There's an example of this, like shelving that is bolted or attached permanently to a wall, or cabinets are not listed there. So I think I may have another question on 1.1 coming up, but there's your answers. Raise your hand if you got all four of those. Let's see how well you did. Did you get it? You got three of the four, John? Okay. All right. Three. Ron, I'm going through my pages here. Anybody else?
Peg Marty with the
Peg
win.
Did. Peg got all four. Nice.
I think the one that people forget is the one that says owned. And the reason they slipped that in there years ago is because we used to, everybody had these water soften machines that they didn't own. They were leased. and everybody thought they were buying them, and that caused problems. That's why that word owned got stuck in there.
Yep, very good point. Okay.
Why does it look like you've done an episode of Dateline?
Yeah. Let's go to number three, Joe. Mr. Hulk. Okay. Name the addendum that could accompany 1.2. All right, what is it? This is a pretty simple one. Name the addendum that could accompany 1.2. All right, raise your hand if you got it. Okay, now we're getting our confidence back. Okay, maybe I can do real estate. All right, Mark, what's the answer?
It's the personal property transfer addendum.
Nice, okay. All right, so if we're gonna get personal property, let's use that addendum. It's a separate agreement. It's written as a separate contract, so be careful with that language. We'll, in further other classes, we could do deeper dives into this, but that is the answer. Okay, that's number three. Okay, let's do number four. Number four, this has to do with water. To be sure that water shares are included, what would be written in the blank in section 1.4? Now, guys, I'm looking for a simple answer here, not the long drawn out, water detail, but there's a pretty simple answer here. What would it be? Yeah,
they're all getting it.
Nope. They're getting it.
Everyone's getting it.
They're sort of getting it.
Yep. All right. Now, if you were around 2007, remember the old REPC, you actually had to state what you wanted included. Nod, you guys remember that? And then we did a 180, and now the blank is none. So some veteran agents still look at that blank and go, wait a minute, am I supposed to write something in here or not? So they've got that one, Kev, Mark, they're doing good on that one.
Yes.
Okay, let's do number five. We've got two more warm-up questions, and then we're going to get pretty detailed, okay? All right, let's do number five, Joe. Okay, what addendum would accompany section 2.2? You know, I'd love for you guys to not look at 2.2 and know what it is. That would be awesome. So can you do it? Do you know what would go along with section 2.2? Okay. Yeah. So the answer to number four, Mariah, is none. Yeah. Yep. None. So that's number four. Number five. So this particular addendum is what? Mark, you want to?
I see a number of folks have it. The subject to sale of buyer's residence.
Right. Must accompany it.
A lot of folks are getting it.
Yeah. This is a good addition to the REPC. We're making the other party affirm that they really do have a property to sell. Unfortunately, that was not always disclosed. So now it's part of the contract. So they've got to double down on that affirmation. So, okay, number six. So this is back to a 1.1 item. Which of the following items is not listed in section 1.1? See how well you do there. Is it light bulbs? Is it water softener? Is it installed TVs? Is it solar panels? Is it bathroom mirrors? Which one is not there in 1.1, not listed? As a matter of fact, we can probably just go and check that out really quick. I'll share the screen again, and we'll go back to section 1.1 and see how we do. Okay, Mark, you wanna go ahead and answer question number six, which one is not included?
Sure, installed TVs are not included in that list. Installed TV mounting brackets are, as they are actually affixed to the property, in place on the property.
Yeah, so now that we go back to this, see the following items, that four-point test becomes pretty important, doesn't it? Because it's not listed as an included item, the mounting bracket is included. So I know these can be contentious issues, you know, at closing and walkthrough, you know, when people take possession. So we want to be clear and communicate clearly, make sure everybody understands. If we're going to leave TVs, we're going to need to address that in the personal property addendum or in another fashion, okay? So that is not included. Okay, that's our six warm-up questions. Raise your hand if you got all six correct. Anybody? Actually, how many did you get? Listen, did anyone get all six? You got five, Sally. Peg got six. Nice job. Good. Kevin, thank you for voting. Victoria, Cindy. Okay. All right. Craig Lelis, you got all five. You got all six. Kevin Larson, I know you got all six. Okay. Congratulations. Okay, you made it through the warm-up phase. Now promise me, let's do an affirmation, okay? It goes like this. Affirmation, okay? I am a high-level professional. Okay? I have mastered the REPC. Okay? All right, that's my affirmation. You just keep that positive energy going because we're going to turn up the dials here. Okay. All right, question number seven, Joe. Let's do number seven. All right, what period of time is considered a short-term rental? Go ahead, and you know what? Don't send it to everyone. Please don't text it, chat it to everyone. Hit my name, yeah, hit my name and send it to me. Let's see how well you do. That way you can be, you can just, you know, you can guess, I guess, if you want to, and see how well you do. All right, you guys are sending them in. I can tell you, I've got the wrong answer. Double check. All right, good job, you guys. Okay, Mark. All right, let's give the answer. And you know what? For bonus, I'll tell you what. For bonus, tell me where the answer's found. Okay, if you know where it's found, Mark, go ahead and what is the answer to what is defined as a short-term rental?
Anytime less than 30 consecutive days.
Okay, how many of you got that right? Yes? Congratulations. Okay, can you tell me where it's found? Hannah, nice job, Hannah. Jim, Dallas, Leslie.
You got it.
Tyler's on it. Okay, nice job, you guys. Okay, good. Okay, you're feeling good about yourself. Remember your affirmation if you got it wrong. Okay. All right. You ready for number eight? All right. Let's do number eight. Why does the REPC say a portion of the earnest money deposit could be non-refundable before financing and appraisal deadline? Why does it say that? What is it referencing here? What's going on? Why would only a portion of the earnest money, look at Billy, he's going, oh man, don't I know this? Why would a portion of it be non-refundable? Yeah, hit me with the private chats, guys. That way you can, especially those who don't have your video on, would you please engage? So if anyone argues you were not paying attention, I can come back and say, yes, they were. See, they've got answers. Okay, a lot of good right answers here. Mark, let's not hold them up. What's the answer to this? Why do we have a portion of the earnest money non-refundable?
Sure. This is a 8.3B1 provides that before the financing appraisal deadline, if the buyer in the buyer's sole discretion determines that the terms and conditions of any financing are not acceptable, then the parties can pre-agree by filling in the blank in 8.3B1 to an amount that the seller would receive once the buyer makes that determination that the financing is unacceptable.
Perfect. Okay.
And the parties can also pre-agree to $0.
Right. You know, I think it's important if you want to put some weight behind due diligence, I think you need to have something in there. If you have a zero, you're essentially just allowing the cancellation to occur for sole discretion, which is Mark just said, at financing and appraisal. So if you want due diligence to matter on the seller side, there should be some amount there. And that would be the portion that's non-refundable. Okay. Very, very good. All right. How many of you got that one right? Can you? Yep. Nice. Okay. Good job, you guys. Let's do number nine. Question number nine. We're almost halfway through. Okay. If $1,000 appears in 8.3BI, that should be I, I think, not II. What would happen to the buyer's earnest money if the property does not appraise for the agreed upon sales price? Simple answers here. Don't overthink this one. Just what happens if we don't have it appraised for value and there is money in 8.3 BI? What happens there? Go ahead and hit the answers. Let me know how you're doing. Okay, is it A, the buyer would lose their earnest money deposit, B, the earnest money would be in 8.3 would be refunded to the buyer, C, the amount listed in 8.3 would be lost, the remaining amount refunded, or D, all the earnest money would be refunded to the buyer if it does not appraise for value. So which one is it? A, B, C, D, which one is it?
Well, it's kind of all over the place. If you look at the voting, everybody's thinking C or D, so there's not 100% here.
Yeah, right. That's right. It's good. That's, hey, you know, we're here to learn, right? So this is a common question. Look, all the brokers on the call, Craig and Kevlar and Kev Cam and Mark and I, look, we're getting this question a lot. Are we sure that Section 8.2 would govern if it doesn't appraise? And Mark, do you want to address that?
Well, we'd have to revert to Section 8.2 and not Section 8.3. Because the reason for any cancellation by the buyer would be based on 8.2. The property didn't appraise, so all of the earnest money would be returned to the buyer. And 8.3, it's somewhat of a trick question. It doesn't matter what's in 8.3.
The confusion of that way it's written, which we, Craig and I have found with a lot of you, is the fact that it references the appraisal and financing deadline. And because they're one date. And so everybody gets confused to think you can't use the appraisal to get out of it. It's just referencing the deadline date. It's not referencing the requirement that it's still subject to appraisal. So don't get confused by that, but D is the answer there. And it was interesting, you guys were about 50-50 on that, but D is the answer. Do not get confused.
Yeah. So I think another reason for the confusion is because 8.3 comes after 8.2. And so we're trained that addendums, trump main body contract language, but in the main body of the contract, they work together. You know, one doesn't cancel out the other. So remember that. But I think if the forms committee goes to redo this, I think we're, and they will, because that's just the nature of these contracts, is we'll probably work to have that clarified. So, okay, very well said. Thank you, Kevin, for your input also. Okay, all right, let's do the next question. So this is number 10. When the REPC is conditioned upon financing, if the buyer fails to obtain financing, the seller may what? Sue the buyer for damages. Only keep the earnest money deposit. C, return the earnest money to the buyer and sue for damages, or D, require professional therapy to deal with disappointment. Joe, come on. That should be the laugh track, not the crickets. Okay. I got to get the DJ on my side. I don't know what I'm doing here. You know, if you can't tell, I'm having a ball. So join me, won't you? All right, what's the answer here? So, this has come up lately with this really competitive offer, writing that we're doing to win these bids. I think we need to consider, if you don't make it subject to financing, what happens if you don't get financing? So to the buyer's, their status with the seller, and whether they're opening themselves up for further litigation. So Mark, do you want to give us the answer on that one?
I'm seeing a lot of correct answers, which is B, but I'm also seeing B and D together. Okay. The answer is the buyer may only keep the earnest money deposit, and it's governed by Section 8.3B3. That provision provides that the earnest money deposit, the parties pre-agree that in these circumstances where buyer fails to obtain the loan, the earnest money is liquidated damages.
Yeah, I think we could probably put D with a lot, right? Okay. It's Dr. Weinberg. Okay. 801. No, just. Okay. Joe, where's my laugh track? Seriously. I mean, I'm working here. You know, I'm working and I got crickets. For those who are smiling, thank you so much. Yeah, I really appreciate it.
Poor Will.
I know. I'm working here, you know? Tough crowd. All right, let's do number 11. Here we go. Describe a permissible transfer. This is, you know, advanced real estate here. What's a permissible transfer? And again, bonus would be what section would we go to find the definition of permissible transfer? This is a big deal because, we're talking about what's okay to assign and what's not okay to assign. And there's often confusion, especially when we write in things like and or assigns on the buyer line, okay? So there's some contractual terms here where the seller is forbidding some things. So, okay, go ahead and give me your answer. Tara, nice job. Okay, Mark, you want to dive on this one?
Sure. A permissible transfer is not an assignment. It's a transfer to a legal entity or business entity in which the buyer maintains a legal or ownership interest. A lot of times, as Will said, buyers will put and or assigns in the buyer line. And if you read section 19, which is where this provision is addressed, and or assigns only permits a permissible transfer. So it has to be to a business entity in which the buyer maintains an ownership interest.
What do we have for him, Johnny?
I'll take door two.
Okay, door number two. All right. Okay, nice job. Okay, let's move on. So let's do number 12, Joe. We're about halfway with our time. We're 30 minutes in. And we're about halfway through our questions. So let's do number 12. This one is kind of like, do you know the REPC sections? Okay. I would highly recommend that you memorize the REPC sections. It's very, very helpful. What section says the property will be sold in as is condition? Is it 10-1? Is it 10-2? Is it 10-3? Or I don't know sections of the REPC, and it served me just fine to this point.
I like D personally.
Finally. Whew, okay. All right. I'll have to remember this. Here, let me write that joke down that it was a keeper. That's a keeper. Okay. So what section says as is? Did you know this one or did you have to look? I hope you knew it without looking. I'm going to share on this one and maybe I can take this one, Mark.
Sure.
I think, okay, well, here they are, guys. Screen's jumping a little bit. Pardon me. Just one second. Let me grab those section 10 there. Okay. So here's the warranty section. 10-1 is the home warranty plan. And Kevin Larson actually brought this up yesterday in our sales meeting, that this was a petition by the home warranty companies to have this added in to our state contracts. And even the Attorney General's office, you know, looks at these and forms committee starts and then they approve it. And this was a successful lobby effort and convinced really the Attorney General's office and the forms committee that it was good. It was a good thing. So there's warranty. 10.2 is the as is. There it is right there, as is condition. It's if I could rewrite the REPC here myself, I would switch these around. I think it's important to get the as is protection. The seller must do everything that's in 10.3. So, I think they're kind of backwards, frankly. I said, you know, if you want as is, we've got to do this, because if you don't complete disclosure, any item you do not disclose, you are not going to be able to hide behind as is protection. Okay. So often I've referred to that as kind of a baton that's a burden, you know? So whatever you're holding in your hand, the leaky roof is what you're holding in your hand. So to get that out of your liability, you disclose it. and now you pass that on and have the as is protection. So the answer is B. Okay, the answer is B, 10.2. Okay. All right, let's do 13, Joe. Question 13. This one has to do with additional earnest money. Okay, additional earnest money is due when? Yeah, when is additional earnest money due? This is a great way to make a competitive offer, by the way. Guys, you don't pay more with additional earnest money. If the buyer is solid in their ability to obtain financing, this would be a great way to make a better offer. I think listing agents should look at this closer when they're determining the strength of offers. Okay, I'm getting a lot of private messages. Nice job. Yeah, go ahead and weigh in. I'll give you five more seconds, and then Mark, you can take this one.
I'm seeing a lot of due diligence, which is half of the answer. The answer is actually it's by the later of the due diligence deadline or the financing and appraisal deadline. So it's the later of those two by which additional earnest money is due.
Okay, yeah, that's it. When all the conditions are out of the way, then the additional earnest money is due. I think that's a strong proposition for a buyer to make. It gives the seller confidence to move out, you know, those moving companies, the deposits there, the expenses. I like this section. I think it gets underused.
I think so too.
Okay, let's do 14. You know, if you know 14, I'm pretty impressed. Okay. The seller can make no alterations to the property after what? Come on, you REPC wizards, you high-level professionals.
They're all getting it right.
A lot of good answers.
Rick, you got Rick Shan, you got the answer? Maybe. See, Rick's a high-level professional. Okay, some weigh in here. Some of you are going everyone when you answer. You're giving everyone the answers. Dallas with his new mustache, Dallas Eichers, his new mustache looking good, San Francisco. You got the answer? You got it? Okay, good. Yeah, another expert. Okay, well, what's the answer, Mark?
Acceptance. I think everybody got it.
Okay, good.
That was 100%, I think.
12.1.
Yeah, that's where we get the answers in 12.1. Okay, very good. All right, let's go on to 15. Question 15. Seller may not create any additional short-term rentals after what? After what? There's a moment in time where they cannot create any more short-term rentals. You know, our Wasatch back agents, I'm telling you, they are mic dropping on this one. This one they know so well, right? But maybe our Wasatch front agents are going, we just don't deal with a lot of short-term rentals, which is true. A lot of our markets don't deal with short-term rentals. But okay, so this one you know, right? Okay. Seller may not create any additional short-term rentals after what? And, you know, if you know the section, write it down. That'd be so cool if you knew the section. You're like, hang on a sec, Will. Let me get the REPC out and just bruise through it here. I'll just, you know, find that section. Okay, Mark, what is it?
I'm seeing a lot of answers that are due diligence. And it's actually, if you think about it, it's before that. It's the seller disclosure deadline, because that's when a seller would have to disclose rentals that are on the books. So if we allow it to be the due diligence deadline, that's a later period of time, and it might not pick up bookings after the seller disclosure deadline. So the actual deadline is seller disclosure, and it's section 12.5.
Nice. I'm going down the list here. Augusta got it. Travis got it. Stella got it. Nicole, good job. Brooke. Yeah, good job, you guys. John, Tara, 12.5. Nice job. Okay, let's do number 16. Okay, assuming the buyer has not defaulted, what circumstance can the seller cancel a contract. This is an interesting one. If a seller wants to get out, let's say the buyer has not defaulted and the seller wants to cancel. Is there a way out? If there is, what is it? Okay. Hit me with the private chat first and let's see how you do. You can send it to Mark or I or.
Okay, he assassinates the buyers.
What, Kev?
He has to assassinate the buyer.
Yeah. You got crickets on that one, Kev.
I sort of heard him. I heard him.
Yeah. All right. This is an interesting one. It's a horrible thing to have a seller have seller's remorse or want to get out. It's happened a few times. And in this fast-paced market, it's, you know, we're hearing about it a lot. It's not common, I would say, but it's coming up a little bit. Frankly, because some sellers in higher price points are surprised they that the property sold so fast. So, okay, Mark, go ahead and tell us what our answer is here.
Sure. I saw a lot of folks got it. Section 20.2 addresses risk of loss. If there's damage to the property in excess of 10% of the purchase price, the seller can cancel the contract. That's the only out, if you will, other than a seller default under section 16.2. I saw some of you put that. That's kind of a roll the dice out because the buyer obviously has additional remedies other than just return of the earnest money upon a seller default.
Okay, very good. So there'd have to be damage to the property. I think that's the answer. Okay.
Yes.
All right, 17 has to do with what's required to have acceptance. So what are the two things that are required to have acceptance? Write those down and let's see how you do. Two things that require acceptance. And I wanna warn everybody on something here when you get all these done. And by the way, tell me what section. What section, if you've got, a lot of you guys are getting it right. What section defines that? That'd be easy to find because it's labeled acceptance. So you can just go through and go, oh yeah, there it is. All right, good job, you guys. Nice job, and thanks for playing along. I appreciate that. Okay, it's section 23. So I think I'll just take this one, Mark.
Sure.
So this is simply signatures are required and communication is required. Okay, let's up the ante here a little bit, make it more complicated. Remember, there sometimes we're tempted to do so many days after acceptance. That's not the preferred method. Okay, not the preferred method. We'd rather have dates. And the reason for that is because occasionally we have a signature on one date and communication on another. It can happen because they're two different events. And when that happens, it creates ambiguity on what the deadline is, which we don't want because these deadlines are very critical to what happens with earnest money and whether or not someone's in default. So we do not want to see so many days from acceptance because sometimes we have two different things going on with two different dates, okay? So make a note of that. Okay, I think we're ready for 18. We're getting on the home stretch here. All right, what three things must happen in order for closing to occur? Closing to occur, three things. One, two, three, do them in order if you can, and then it would be nice if you could tell me what sections those are. I know a lot of you know this answer. It's good exercise, good practice.
He didn't say settlement, he said closing.
Yeah, I said three things for closing to occur. Okay, closing. Yeah. And let's do those in order. And while you're waiting, if you've already got it, let's go see where those answers are found. Okay. And a lot of you are getting that right. Sally, the direct message, I got it. Nice job. Cindy, good job. Let's see who else in there. Yeah, Joel Pack, you got it. And then you're in the right order. Okay, Mark, let's do the answer.
Sure. First, settlement must have occurred, and settlement occurs when everything under 3.1 has occurred. Separate question. So settlement must have occurred, funding must have occurred, and the documents, relevant documents, must have been recorded. So settlement, funding, and recordation.
Yeah, it's, you know, in the lingo that we often use, we go to a closing. I think the public thinks, oh, we're going to go close on our house. Did you close today? But, you know, we do need to coach them on that, especially when you're talking about sensitive issues like possession, because so often possession is tied to closing. And now you just need to talk that through. And I know a lot of you know how to do that, but it's that's a good practice to remember that, look, three things have to happen even to get to closing before we take possession. So very good. Okay, the number 19, which is next, is kind of an add-on to these other question 18. So let's do 19. Okay, question 19. How many days after settlement must closing happen? Okay, how many days do we have? And by the way, tell me what kind of days. Nice job. Nice. Yep. Okay. Yeah, Katie, you got it. You got it. Okay, these are calendar days, not business days. They're calendar days. I wish you guys could have been in the forums committee discussion when we were debating on what kind of days to use. And when you're like, what's a business day? Nobody knew. What's a banking day? Oh, it's a federal holiday. Is it a banking day? I mean, and then we're like, you know, maybe we should just use calendar. And if, matter of fact, it was so simple. Okay. Let's look at this. This is funny to me. It was so simple that when the attorneys went to write how to describe a calendar day, look at what they said here. Okay. Performance under each section of the REPC, which is referenced to date, shall absolutely be required by 5 p.m. on that date. And the term days and calendar days shall mean what? Calendar days. No one could think of another way to say calendar days. Like, it's a calendar day? So anyway, yeah, all right. I think that's good material. Where's my laugh track?
I couldn't shut this down. You were sharing your screen.
Okay. Oh, shoot. That's right. Zoom won't allow the laugh tracks if you're sharing screen. Okay. Anyway, I hope you get a crack up of that one. That one's so simple that you go, yeah, a calendar day is, it's calendar day. Yeah, that's how we describe that. It's calendar. We just use the calendar and there's the days. So, okay. All right. Four calendar days. Good. Let's go on to number 20. We only got 5 more left. And we got 10 more minutes. Here we go. How do you properly document the resolution of due diligence items under section 8.1? Okay. Kind of a complicated question. It sounds so official, doesn't it? All right. Game show CE. I love it. You know, we do need to figure out a way to give away some money. Then we'd have it all. Okay. Yeah. Mark, go ahead. What do we got here?
Sure. It's the resolution of due diligence addendum. Is how you properly document it. And I think in a minute we'll get to how to use that in connection with the walkthrough inspection.
Yeah, so we'll save that. I think we'll do a little deeper dive on this one, but process is to take, look, you can email over home inspections, you can email over some requests, that's all fine. But once you come to a resolution as to what's gonna be done, then we need to go into the resolution due diligence or resolution of due diligence addendum, okay? All right, 21. All right, 4 more, we're almost finished. How many times does a REPC say earnest money can be released to a party without authorization from the other party? We talked about this in a previous CE class about earnest money. Does anyone remember how many times a REPC says that it can be released without authorization of the other party? This has to do with the discussion of title companies having earnest money, you know, that the REPC says many times that it doesn't have a requirement of authorization of the party, but title companies, of course, do. So we would be undoing all that language. So here, this question saying, well, how many times does the REPC actually say that it's it can be released without the other party's authorization? So let's take a guess. And on this one, hey, hit everybody on this one. That would be, we're all over the board here. I got 12.
Most people think none.
There's a lot of none, right.
A lot of nones.
8, 4.
You haven't read the whole REPC if you put none.
Okay, guess what I've got. I'll guess what I've got. I got the answer. Mark, you can speak the answer, and then I guess I can show it here.
Sure. Yeah,
there's 8.1B
might be the first one.
Yep, there's one, there's two, mm-hmm. and there's three, there's four, there's five, and I think that's it.
That's it.
That's it. Wow. 5 times. How many of you got that right? Didn't we get that right?
I didn't see anybody. No. Maybe 1 or 2.
Somebody solid got it right. Anybody else on page 2?
Travis got it.
Travis got it. Okay. Nice job. Okay. We just got a few more. Let's go to number 22. Number 22. This is Marc Obrien and Will Cooper's favorite document, because this is a cover your assets so form. Look, there's a lot of benefits to having affiliated arrangements, which we have in our brokerage. Anytime you have affiliated business arrangements, RESPA requires disclosure of those and certain rules that surround them. For one, that the client is given options, that they're educated on the fact that there is a relationship. And this agreement accomplishes that for us. So it's very, very important. Even if the client in the beginning has no intentions of using services, they may later in the future decide to. So it's really important to have that signed. And there's a lot of benefits for this. I mean, this is your one-stop shop. These are relationships that we've got proven track records with our affiliates, and they're very valuable team members. So it's really a good thing for our clients. But to do it properly, we need this. So the question is, when should you present the affiliate business disclosure? Ideally, when should that happen? What do you think? Let me get my chat lined up here. Okay.
I like Debbie Sexton and Judy Glauser's answers. Every time and immediately.
yeah.
Music to my ears.
Right. Mark, do you want to go any deeper on that one?
Sure. The technical answer is that it should be presented for execution anytime you mention any of the brokerage's affiliated businesses for the first time, whether it be mortgage or title or any other. A common place to do it and an acceptable place to do it would be upon execution of the buyer broker agreement. That makes sense as well.
I like it. Write down buyer, consultation meeting. This is where if we could have the buyer broker agreement talked about there, if we could have the entire process talked about there, and we've spoken about this in coaching sessions about all the meat that goes into a great buyer consultation meeting. Guys, the market is getting more complicated. There's more issues going on. We do need to pause and explain to buyers, don't just lead convert and go from house to house to showing until they finally commit to one. Pause that chaos in that assembly line and discuss the complexities. This is where the affiliate agreement could be injected, okay? So, when you see a low BAC, and you haven't had a buyer consultation meeting, you're behind the eight ball, okay? You're late in the game, and it just because it feels self-serving, right? To talk about your fee when it's low, get out ahead of that, and you'll do a lot better, okay? And that's where the affiliate agreement goes, okay? All right, we only have 3 more questions, and we've only got about 5 more minutes or so, so let's go on to the next one, 23, I think, yeah, 23. Okay, if the appraisal condition is checked, this was an actual case. So the appraisal condition is checked. So it is conditioned. The financing condition is not checked. Okay. And then section 24C deadline says NA. Can the buyer cancel if the appraisal comes in low? What do you think? This was a serious brain teaser here. Mark, wouldn't in law school, don't we argue both ways on this one?
It can be argued both ways. I think there's a better answer.
Okay. Good. All right. So maybe part of this lesson here is to not do this, right? There's a real flaw in this particular scenario, but Mark, take it on, because I think this one was a real case. So we're seeing agents wanting to check one box over here and not the other. What was the big mistake? Maybe I could ask you this. What was the big mistake the agent made? Was it checking the boxes or not putting a deadline in section 24?
It's the latter. It's not putting a deadline in, because checking the condition, the appraisal condition, was checked. And in my view, and I think the correct view, is that that's an absolute condition to the contract, the appraisal. And if in not filling out the deadline, it left it open all the way to settlement, in my view. So the buyer can cancel all the way up until settlement based on that low appraisal, I think, is the better answer.
I agree with that.
Yeah. So if you're silent on the deadline, is there a deadline? You know, so I think that's kind of what you and I were debating yesterday, Mark, is if you were silent on it, then there isn't one. And I think that that's not good. Right. And I'll tell you what, if people get sideways here, we just don't want those, we don't want to become the target, so we still need a deadline in section 24. Okay. All right, so that was kind of our brain teaser there. Let's go to 24. This is another high-level brain teaser. How does the REPC address an HOA assessment that's under discussion? Okay, it's only reflected in the HOA minutes provided in the disclosure, but not yet approved prior to closing. So there's a discussion at the HOA about fees. It shows up in the minutes, but it's not approved yet. And it certainly isn't approved before closing. So what happens here? Anyone ever have this where you have, unapproved fees that may be coming? Yes. Everyone's like, I don't really want that in my universe, Will. Ominous. it does sound like a horror movie for a transaction, because we don't want a commissionectomy here, because all commissionectomies are done without anesthetic, and I'm telling you, they're very painful, and nobody likes that. So to avoid the commissionectomy, Mark, what's the story here?
The REPC doesn't address it directly. It addresses it indirectly. The buyer would be responsible for those costs to the extent they were later on approved or assessed after closing. So the way to address it is through negotiation. If the buyer becomes aware as part of due diligence, you'll want to address it with the buyer in an addendum and try to allocate based on the likelihood of those expenses becoming approved down the road after closing.
Okay, so we better deal with them. That's why it's so important to go through that information with our seller, get it out on the table and address it. Critical. All right, we've got one more and we're gonna do a little deeper dive and kind of come back up to due diligence and talk about walkthrough. This is our last question, and then we'll do some final thoughts and then we'll conclude. So, all right, Joe, let's do number 25. Okay, what items are subject to review or approval at the pre-settlement walkthrough? Okay, so it's asking what really are you doing in a walkthrough? So this would be governed by what section? This would be governed by section 11. It's listed in 11, the sections that we are confirming in walkthrough. So the first part of this question is, what are the items? Okay, yeah, let's see it. Yeah, Dallas, good job. All right, we've got Dallas, you nailed it, by the way. Dallas Eichers nailed it. Perfect answer. Nice job. That was impressive. So there's really three things here. Here's the right answer. It's 1.1. It's 1.2. It's 8.1 BII. What is 8.1 BII? So if you're going to go look at that, grab your REPC, take a look at B. And wait, I think that's a mis. Yeah, 8.1. Yes, BII. Otherwise, the items that are that could have been repaired or addressed. Now, Mark, talk about the timing of this and how it's a little skewed.
Sure. If you look at Section 11, the pre-settlement walkthrough is to be done no earlier than 7 days prior to settlement. Now, if we go back and look at the resolution of due diligence addendum we talked about earlier, that allows, by its terms, allows for the negotiated items to be repaired. The deadline for those repairs is all the way until settlement. So you may actually conduct your pre-inspection walkthrough 7 days prior to settlement when the repairs have not yet been made. So you're there to confirm that they've been made, but they're not required to have been made pursuant to the addendum you signed. So the important lesson here is maybe you want to revise the addendum to provide a date certain so that when you do your pre-settlement walkthrough, those items will be completed.
Yeah, so if the seller is going to have to do the repairs, and we know that's the last option, we don't want that done at settlement. But that's what the resolution says. It's not due till settlement. It's very frustrating. I think if you're going to have the seller do repairs, you want those done by walkthrough, and then determine a date, as Mark said, because that's just really frustrating. You get there and find out, hey, did these guys do the work or not? You know, I thought we were here to check to see if the work was done, and so. That can be a problem. So that's a little tweak. I think that's another high level understanding, a professional level, and how we protect our clients. Guys, we are not going to go long. Let me just put a bow on this. Thank you, first of all, for your participation and your willingness to sharpen the saw and become a better professional. We try to make it fun and joke around a little bit today, but I think we have a very worthy cause. Which to protect our clients with a passion and a high level professionalism. But Nate, make no mistake about it, there's a lot of effort behind the study. You really have to go searching and have wisdom behind the knowledge and understanding with the experiences that come. A lot of those are around us, the experiences around us, so ask. And do yourself a favor and enjoy it along the way, because I think it's our saving grace, Mark. Don't you think this is one of those items that you just can't put technology around? Yeah.
Absolutely. It is fun. And when you get into the REPC and you really study it and you look at each one of these blanks, in many cases is an opportunity to show your professionalism and better serve your client. There's strategies and tools and techniques you can use in filling these blanks out if you really understand the REPC. That's where we're trying to get.
We should be, all of us, a beacon for the way that a professional acts on the highest level, you know, and we should really master all of this process. I love you all, proud of each one of you. So glad that we get to work together and have such a worthy cause to help people find a right home for them, navigate the murky waters, and to help sellers move on to a new chapter of life. It's a very worthy cause. A home is worth the effort, right? And family and people are worth the effort. I'm going to go ahead and sign off. Joe.